like to say a pleasant good day to all of you, and I wish you God's richest blessing. The Bible says, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us be glad and rejoice in it. It gives me great privilege and great opportunity to speak to you on this very special occasion. And I thank the individuals who made it possible for me to be your speaker today. I hope that something I say today will be of benefit to those that are listening. Our subject today is running to win. My text today comes from Hebrews chapter 12, reading from verse 1 to verse 3. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despised the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endures such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest you be weary and faint in your minds. Let us pray. Father God, we ask that you will come in this solemn hour. You will take charge of the speaker of this time, of the hour. You will put words in his mouth. I pray, Lord, that you will allow the listeners to be receptive to the words that they shall hear, and that they will leave this place with a greater spirit of joy and happiness and peace and commitment. Follow you all the way. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. They grabbed the old Nigerian pastor and thrust him violently into the center stage of the makeshift platform that they had built in the center of town. And the young militants began shouting at him and said, "Why don't you curse Christ? Forsake him." The old Christian pastor stood up with defiance, looked them straight in the eyes without saying a word. One of the young militants took out a machete, sharp machete, and with one mighty swipe severed the hand of this old preacher. Blood spurted everywhere. The onlooking audience gasped with terror and fear at what had just happened. I want you to hold that story. We'll come back to it. The passage under consideration today is running to win. The first thing I want you to notice about this passage, in verse 1, it says, therefore, seeing we are so compassed with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset, and let us run. First point I want you to understand. Let us run. Christianity may be built in a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, but it is not private. We never run alone. We're part of a larger community. This is not a solitary run. We are running together. Like the ancient Hebrews, we're journeying together to Canaan. And we need each other. We need one another. We need the encouragement, the support. We need help from our fellow believers when we're discouraged, when we're sick, when we're depressed, when we're downcast, when we're disappointed. We need the prayers of each other. Oh, yes, I remember the song we used to sing. It says, I need the prayers of those I love. while traveling o'er life's rugged way, that I may true and faithful be and live for Jesus every day. I want my friends to pray for me, bear my tempted soul above, and intercede with God for me. I need the prayers of those I love. I am reminded of the story of Derek Rodman, who was running a race in the Olympics, it was a 400 meter. And as he made the final bend for home, he got a muscle cramp and he fell down, but he got up and he began trying to hobble along toward the finishing line. Now his father, who was in the audience, saw what had happened and he jumped over the security barriers, beyond the security guards, lifted up his son, took him by the arms, and together, both of them hobbled towards the finishing line. My friends, this is what we need when we are in trouble. And God, through our fellow believers, sometimes will come to our aid in the midst of a crisis. As I think about that story, I'm also reminded of a well-known story that perhaps some of you have heard, of a man who had a dream that he was walking along the shore of the sea in the sand. And as he was walking, he noticed there were two sets of footprints. But at a certain point in the journey, he noticed there was only one set of footprints. And he recognized that when there was only one set of footprints were the times in which he felt the worst. He was the most lonely. He was the most depressed. And he turned to God and he said, God, what happened? It seems as if when I was at my lowest point, I was alone. Jesus looked him tenderly in the eye and he said, son, when you were at your lowest point, it was at that moment that I took you in my arm and I carry you along. It is for that reason why you had one set of footprints. My friends, when we are at our lowest point, it is when God is closest to us. You see, my friends, when we run together, we support each other. We encourage each other. We can accomplish far more helping each other, because by helping each other, we help ourselves. When we save others, we also save ourselves. I'm reminded of another story again of two men that were caught in a blizzard. And in this midst of this terrible snowstorm, one of the men became discouraged. He felt he could no longer carry on the journey. And he told his friend, go ahead, leave me. At least save yourself. His friend was unwilling to leave him behind. And so, exerting all of the strength and effort that he had, he lifted his friend on his shoulder, and with much exertion and effort, he struggled until he came to a cabin where there was light and they were both rescued. But in reflection, that friend recognized that if he had not stopped to help his fellow traveler on this journey by lifting him up and putting him on his back, it provided warmth for him. By exerting that effort, he was able to have more energy and strength. So by helping to save his friend and brother, he also saved himself. Oh yes, my friends, we can do far more when we run together, when we put our resources together. You see, there is a law called the law of synergy that says our combined efforts are greater and can do far more than the sum total of our individual efforts. Our combined efforts can accomplish far more than the sum total of our individual efforts. Let me illustrate it for you. They did an experiment in Canada in which they had two oxen. One was able to pull 500 pounds. Another was able to pull another 500 pounds. So together, the sum total of their individual efforts came out to 1,000 pounds. They noticed when they yoked these two oxen together, when they put their they combined their strength together. Instead of pulling 1,000 pounds, these two oxen were able to pull 1,500 pounds. The law of synergy says 1 + 1 = 3. 1 + 1 = 3. Our combined efforts can accomplish far more than the sum total of our individual efforts. You see, when we run together, we can accomplish far more. I understand this principle myself. I do a lot of running. I do triathlons, and I was running in a particular triathlon in Naples, Florida, some years ago. This particular race consisted of 1 mile of swimming in the ocean. It's around 30 miles bike riding, and then you finish the race with a 10K, 6.2 miles. I swam in the ocean for around a mile. Then I rode the bike for another almost 30 miles. And then the final leg of this triathlon was 10K, 6.2 miles. By this time, my energy was sapped. My legs were like lead. I could hardly move. But I struggled on. And as I was coming to around the final mile and a half of the journey, I saw a woman. She looked discouraged. She wanted to give up. And I stopped. And I went alongside her and I told her, "What is happening?" She said she doesn't think she can make it. I said, "Yes, you can. You can make it. Come on, let's do it together." And I encouraged her. And together, we kept on running. And I noticed that as I stopped to help her, I myself became energized. I became filled with greater energy and effort. In helping her, I helped myself. There's a book written by Alan Lutz called The Healing Power of Doing Good, in which they explain the relationship between good health and voluntary. And they studied over 3,000 men and women and discovered that volunteering is actually good for your mental health. His research concluded that regular helpers are 10 times more likely to be in good health than people who don't volunteer. They experience less stress, less pain, less insomnia, they live longer. And this was attributed to a special biochemical called endorphins. These endorphins reduce the body's stress and releases these special, and the biochemical explanation is that these endorphins are released in the body and they're the natural painkiller. I read a statement by Ellen White, which was quite surprising, from the book Welfare Ministry, page 303. He says, "Doing good is a remedy for disease." Doing good is a remedy for disease. Those who engage in the work are invited to call upon God, and he has pledged himself to answer them. My first point I want you to understand this morning, friends, is that we must run together. By running together, we help each other and we help ourselves. Second point, how should we run? How should we run? The writer says, "Let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us." How should we run? We should run with patience and laying aside every weight. Laying aside every weight. This race that we're all in is a marathon. We have to run with patience. You got to learn to pace yourself. I used to be a runner, as I said, many years ago, and I lived in the country of Panama. I ran the 10,000 meter race. I remember in that particular race, I was just running very hard, but there was a particular runner that was running very hard. But I said, "No, I'm just going to keep my steady pace." I kept at the very steady pace. And as we came to the final lap, I kicked it into high gear. It's called the runner's kick. And as I started to stretch my legs out and move with greater speed, because I had paced myself throughout the race, this runner who had been running hard tried to keep up with me, but he had run out of energy. And he could not finish the race. And of course, I was victorious in that race. You got to pace yourself, my friends. It is not he who finishes first in this race that wins, but he who finishes. We can all be winners. We can all be winners. You see, patience is an important virtue. Although the idea of patience here comes from the Greek, the idea is of endurance. Endurance. Although patience is important because we live in a society today where people are no longer patient. We no longer believe in delayed gratification. We want what we want and we want it now. We're smitten by what I call the idolatry of the immediacy. Oh, yes. And when you're running a marathon, there are two important things that you need to understand. And that is, you need to know how not to go out too fast at the beginning. That's it, pacing yourself. Then there's another important point, and that is, at some point in the race, you're going to experience what runners call hitting the wall. In other words, it's as if your physical body tells you you can't go on anymore. And it takes mental strength to keep on keeping on when nothing seems, when your body seems to want to stop. My friends, there are times in our experience when we feel like giving up. When we cannot see where we're going, there's only darkness before us. But we must trust him, the Bible. Trust him, one songwriter says, where we cannot trace him. We must take one step at a time. Although we cannot see tomorrow, we cannot see the future, we don't know where the next dollar is coming from, we still must learn to trust God. The second point about how to run the race is we must lay aside every weight and the sin that so easily beset us. The principle here is that to run right, we must run light. To run right, we must run light. In the ancient Greek Olympics, they ran naked, no clothes. They didn't want any drag, any hindrance. In their training, they would run with weights, but on the day of the race, nothing, nada. The text says, notice, it says every weight, not some weight, not a little weight. But every weight, you see, the weight here is not, the word weight here does not necessarily mean something bad. And this is an important point for you to understand. You see, my friends, there are some good things in life that can be a weight to us. They can be hindrances to us in our relationship with God. I dare say this morning, maybe our spouse, our own children, our jobs, our possessions, our money, our recreational activities. Whatever it is that we put before our relationship with God becomes a weight to us, or they weigh us down, or they become a hindrance to us. You see, the devil is very cunning. And this is an important point that you must not miss. If the devil cannot get you to do the bad things or the evil things, he can get you to become preoccupied with the good things. Either way, he's won. If he cannot get you to do the bad things in life, then he can let you to become preoccupied with the good things. And when we become preoccupied with the good things of life, we lose our hold on God. When we fall in love with the gifts of God and forget about the giver, we lose our way. And that becomes idolatrous to us. I'm reminded of another story. In the 1850s, 1840s and 50s in America, there was a great gold rush in California. And so many people travel across the continent in search of fortune and fame. And one particular return trip, there were many who came back from California laden down with gold, gold nuggets. They had gold in their jackets, in their pockets. But unfortunately, that ship ran into a terrible storm. And the captain said to the passengers, Now, in order for you to survive this, you have to leave everything behind. But of course, many of these people who had spent years accumulating their treasure refused. They took their gold bars with them, they put them in their pockets everywhere. And imagine, just as soon as they jumped in the ocean, that the weight of that gold bar took them right down into the bottom of the ocean. And so, my friends, it is possible that if we hold on to the good things of life, they can take us down. You see, we must learn to hold on loosely to the things of life. Don't let them become your gods. Let them not possess you or preoccupy you. My third point about how to run this race, it says we must lay aside every weight and the sin that so easily beset us. The text says the sins that so easily beset us. What are these besetting sins? And how do they hinder us from running the race? You see, sin entangles us and prevents us from running successfully. Imagine if your two feet were tied together. How far would you go? You see, my friends, you cannot live the victorious Christian life if you're living a double life. Some people act pious and religious on Sabbath, but during the week they indulge in sins. From sunset Friday until sunset on Saturday, they act as Christians, but this will never work. You will be consumed by guilt and shame. The most miserable people in life are those Christians who want to do wrong, but they know they could never truly enjoy it because of guilt and shame, and yet they are not enjoying the joyous, happy relationship with Jesus because of their divided loyalty. Oh yes, my friends, these besetting sins can certainly prevent us from running the race successfully. Sins that are near at hand. Tyndale says these besetting sins, he says, are sins that hang on to us. Sins especially that are around us, that hinders our course. Sins that cling to us. They're peculiar sins, are particular sins that we are especially exposed to our natural temperament, our disposition. In other words, some of us have certain proclivity for certain things. Perhaps it's pride, ambition, lust, greed, sins that we indulge in. Oh yes, sins which we've been exposed to, sins that are our special weaknesses. Sins perhaps like gluttony, love of food. Food is a good thing. But if we eat too much of it, we're too greedy. It would certainly bring our destruction. The love of money, the love of ease and comfort. Sin, my friends, takes away our motivation for running. Oh yes, they're like the tentacles of an octopus that prevents us from running the race successfully. The writer goes on to say, verse 2, not only should we lay aside every weight and the besetting sin and to run with patience, but then he says we must look unto Jesus. Keep your eyes on the prize. Our goal, my friend, is not heaven, but Jesus. You see, when you're running in a race, you must have a goal, an objective, a purpose. Here in the race, we are admonished to keep our eyes on Jesus. He is the prize. We must keep our eyes on the prize, looking unto Jesus. In order to be successful in the race of life, we have to fix our eyes on Jesus and not on our fellow runners. Keep our eyes on Jesus. Why is it that we need to keep our eyes on Jesus? Because you see, Jesus is this incredible runner. He has run this race before. He knows every steep corner, every dangerous curve, every steep hill. He is an experienced, victorious runner. The Bible describes him as one who is the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down on the right hand of the throne of God. What does that describe? That describes a victorious runner. He's described as the author and the finisher of our faith. He began the race with us. My friends, Jesus wants to be your fellow runner and coach. Aren't you glad today, my friends? He wants to be your fellow runner and coach to lead you to victory. He says, he's described as the author and finisher of the faith. He began this race with you, and he will finish it with you. He will not quit on you. My wife and I have been running races for many years. My wife has done around 15 half a marathons. I've done around 10. I've done some triathlons and marathons. But there was one particular race that we were running in Miami, and I was a little ways ahead of my wife. And I noticed that she was becoming faint and wanting to fall down. And so I was close to the finishing line, so I turned back to get my wife. I grabbed her by the shoulder. And together, we run and walk until we got to the finishing line. To me, that was my most satisfying race of all. This is what Jesus does for us. Look at what the Bible says. It says, for the joy that was set before him, it is God's pleasure for our salvation. He takes joy in coming for us and taking us to the finishing line. Oh yes, for the joy, what joy it is, my friends, when God looks at you. He's even looking at you right now. He's seeing you in his kingdom. It brings him pleasure. We're told by the prophet Zephaniah that God himself will sing over us. He will sing a triumphant song of victory because his children has finally come home. My friends, this is the joy that keeps him motivated. This is the joy that keeps him going. When he looks down at us through the ages and he sees our struggles, it gives him joy to come to our rescue, to come to save us, my friends. Wherefore, notice the chapter begins, wherefore. Now, it says, seeing we're also compassed with so great a cloud of witnesses. Now, in the old days, the Bible was not divided into chapters. 11 and 12 actually belongs together. 12 is actually the conclusion to chapter 11. What do we have in chapter 11? We have a whole cloud of witnesses. We have a whole group of runners. The great Hall of Fame heroes of the Bible are fellow runners. And after having described how they were victorious, the writer in chapter 12 uses the word wherefore. In the Greek, it's toigarun. It actually is more preferable to say therefore. It's a conclusive statement about what has gone on before. It's a conclusive statement, but it's designed to give us encouragement based on what has happened before. In other words, the testimony of the past runners are designed to encourage us in our own race. The word is toigarun. Come on, let's do it. It's a strong Greek word, and it means, it suggests an exhortation to patient steadfastness. So when we see the word wherefore, it's an exhortation to us who are running presently to say, come on, let's do it. Toigarun. Toigarun, don't quit. Look at what has gone on before you. Look at these great runners. And with your permission, with your indulgence, perhaps we can talk about some of these great runners as we bring our sermon to a close. There is Noah, preached 120 years. What a testimony. He preached about an event that had never happened. He preached about a rain that was to fall day after day, week after week, for 120 years, this runner kept on running. He kept on running. He never quit. He kept on going. He trusted God in the face of hostility, in the face of unbelief. Oh, yes, my friends, that is Father Noah. And then we have another runner, Abraham. Call an exalted father, Abraham. And then Abraham, the father of many nations. And for 100 years, people were calling him a father, and yet he had no children. But he kept on believing. He kept on trusting God. He kept on running. And then his own wife, Sarah, at age 90 years old, mother, yet she had no children, but she kept on running. She kept on believing. She kept on trusting. And then we got another runner, Moses. Moses, oh yes, Moses. The Bible tells us about Moses. Yes, by faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Oh, yes, he tried to do it on his own, but God says, no, Moses, I got to prepare you for this world. 40 years in the desert. Oh, yes, until Moses was ready. And then God brought Moses out of the desert and delivered his people with a mighty work in which he embarrassed and defeated the gods of the Egyptian and opened up the Red Sea and brought deliverance to his people. Oh, yes, Moses is one of those runners. Oh, yes, you can see him running, friends. And then there's Rahab. You know, it's funny. God used all kinds of runners. Pagan prostitute. Oh, yes, from the city of Jericho, who trusted God, believed God. She's listed among the runners. Then there's Gideon. A midget, a pygmy who felt that he was so insignificant, he could do nothing. But yet, God used him to deliver his people. And then there's Daniel, a slave and an immigrant in a foreign land. Then there's Joseph. Oh, yes, all of them are saying, Toigaroon, let's go. You can make it. You can trust him completely. Oh, yes. I remember when Barack Obama was campaigning, he had a phrase in Spanish, si se puede. Si se puede. You can do it, my friends, by the help of God. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. You remember the story I gave at the beginning of the Nigerian path? Blood spreading everywhere. The Nigerian pastor, his hand severed, left hand severed, blood everywhere. Pain and suffering. What would he do? Would he deny his Lord? He raised his right hand in defiance. And with a mighty voice, he said, Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord. My friends, the good news that in your worst and greatest hour, God will give you the strength to carry on. He will give you the strength to carry on, my friends. Yes, he will give you the strength to carry on. Finally, today, as we bring this sermon to a close, one final story. The 1986 New York Marathon, there were 20,000 runners that entered this race. But the person who finished last, his name was Bob Whelan. He finished 19,413th, dead last. But he finished. Bob Whelan completed the New York Marathon in 4 days, 2 hours, 47 minutes, and 17 seconds. It was unquestionable the slowest marathon ever in history. So what made Bob Whelan marathon so special? You see, Bob ran only with his arms. 17 years earlier in Vietnam, the GI in Vietnam, Bob's legs were blown off by a bomb in battle. He had no legs. He sat on a 15-pound saddle and carried his fists with pads. He used his arms to catapult himself forward, one arm length at a time. He could run a mile in an hour. That's real endurance. in the face of adversity. Later on, Bob Weiland would walk across America, taking 4 years. My friends, this morning, we've all been disabled by sin. Sin has taken its toll on us. We cannot finish this race on our own. We need the help of someone. Yes, my friends, it is only by his grace. Only by his grace can we finish this race. Father God, today, there's somebody in the hearing of my voice who's experiencing difficulty and they want to be quitting the race of life. Lord, whether we like it or not, all of us are in this race of life. And you have given to us the formula for victory. We must run together. We must lay aside every weight, every besetting sin. And finally, Father, we must fix our eyes on Jesus, the greatest runner of all. Father, we know that if we follow these principles, victory is assured. Thank you, Lord, for your words today. And we pray that we will implement them. We will apply them to our lives. For we ask it in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.